What could I say? It all seemed to make sense. You've taken away everything, and I can't deal with that. I try to see the good in life, but good things in life are hard to find. Well, blow it away, blow it away. Can we make this something?
How is everybody? You guys are jealous, aren't you? You guys are jealous, I can tell right now. I like Plato. I don't know how many of you guys like Plato. And of course, my two favorite colors are yellow and black as far as, you know, Plato goes. You know, I really like, you know, yellow and black Plato. How many of you like Plato? Come on, let's be honest. Even if you're an adult. Yeah? Yeah? Yeah, I do too. And, the guy that invented Plato, his name was Joe McVicker. And he invented Plato in the 1930s as a wallpaper cleaner. That's what it was. It was a wallpaper cleaner, and it's composed of flour and water and salt and boric acid. It's really kind of my man's falling over, wasn't he? It's kind of a simple, you know, thing. Plato is, and so, you know, he invented it as a wallpaper cleaner, and actually the market started really slowing down when it came to wallpaper cleaning clay, and he heard about this group of students in a nearby Cincinnati elementary school that were, you like this, don't you? You guys are liking this, aren't you? A group of students in a nearby elementary school that used his wallpaper compound to make Christmas ornaments. And gosh, that's terrible. Maybe he doesn't need feet. And, you know, so anyway, voila. You know, he's thinking, wow, you know, these kids used this Play-Doh to make this wallpaper compound. And so he started coloring it, he marketed it, and Joe McVickers, who was a guy who, his family owned a soap company in Cincinnati, that's why they made the cleaning compound, by his 27th birthday, he became a millionaire in the 1940s, because he made this thing called Play-Doh that we've all had a lot of fun with, and I don't know, this isn't working out quite the way I was hoping it to, but, you know, I mean, here's the thing about Plato. Here's the thing that I really love about Plato is that if you mess up, you can take the same lump and you can start all over again. Like, you know, if I don't feel like this arm is really working out for me, you can take the same lump and you can start all over again, no matter what happens. Or like if his legs are too long, you can kind of squish him down or whatever you need to do. But the very same lump you can take and start all over again. You know, I used to do models when I was a teenager. I loved doing model cars. Anybody do model cars, you know, back in the day? I mean, I know some people still do them. And it's different than Play-Doh, because, you know, the thing that was the hardest thing to do was to put the windshield in and to get it in and not get glue on the windshield. You know, does anybody know what I'm talking about? And man, because if you got glue on the windshield, that was it. You know, forget about it. You know, and no matter what great job you did on the paint or anything else, if you got glue on the windshield, that was it. But with Play-Doh, man, you know, you can start all over again, you know, from the same thing. Like, I can make something else out of this tomorrow. It's the greatest thing. It really is. You know, and it's kind of like it's almost like a do-over, where really when it comes down to it, a do-over. And a do-over is when we get to redo a certain action, a certain thing in our life. It's a chance to get to do something that over again that maybe didn't turn out quite the way that we hoped it would turn out. And I know some of you are freaking out because of this hat, so if you don't mind, I'm going to put it over here for a little bit. I know I probably got hat hair now, don't I? But that's okay. But how many of us, you know, can look back on our youth? How many of us can look back, maybe even on last week, and wish that we could have a do-over? How many of you can look back on something in your life and you wish that you could have a do-over? You wish you could kind of do what Plato does and start all over again. I know that there are things in my life where I would love to have a do-over. There are things I look back and I would love to have a do-over, but the reality is that there are a lot of things that's simply not possible. There are things where absolutely there's no way that I can go back and change something. There's no way that a do-over is possible. And I'm sure that some of you wish that in certain aspects of your life that you could have a do-over. Maybe something that you would really like to change if you could change it. But again, maybe like me with some of the things in my life that where a bridge has already been burned, where papers have already been signed or life has already moved on to the point there's no going back. And let me just add a little something in here real quick. You know, one of the things I've learned in my short 40 years is that sometimes we burn bridges. We disconnect with relationships. We disconnect with people because we're mad about something or maybe we don't see something as right. And you know, I have to tell you, I've even done that in my life, and there's been times where I wished I hadn't burnt that bridge. So kind of a sermon within the sermon, just be real careful about burning bridges. You know what I mean by that? About severing relationship ties or maybe severing things in your life that maybe one day could come back to haunt you, because you really never know how God will use things in your life. And the best thing we can do is keep our eyes on Him most of the time instead of trying to handle things our own way anyway, right? Right. Well, how many of us would like a do-over when it comes to your marriage? Or maybe your family life, maybe with your kids. Maybe your marriage has gone stale for one reason or another, or maybe you look at your kids and you realize that they're not making the best choices and you know that what they really need is for mom and dad to be more in their lives, but maybe because of work or because of other things that are going on, maybe you really don't feel like you have the time to spend with your kids. Or maybe you're here this morning and maybe you're here and you're harboring years of bitterness towards your spouse or maybe even a child. You've got years of bitterness that have built up, and even though maybe on the surface things have moved on, there's still that bitterness that is lying underneath the surface. Or maybe you've never quite forgiven your spouse for something that happened, or maybe you've never quite forgiven a child for something they did. Or maybe you wish your spouse took better care of themselves. I mean, you know, maybe you know they would look better for you, or they would take the time to at least do things that made you feel like that they cared about your thoughts and your feelings and your emotion. Or maybe your spouse never listens to you. I know sometimes, guys, I get this, that I'm not the best listener in all the world, but maybe that's a problem and it's driven a wedge in your marriage. Or maybe if you're honest, you're here this morning and you're married, but you can't really say that you're in love anymore. Maybe you're here this morning and if you were really honest, you don't feel that flame that you once felt. In fact, you don't even see a spark. You feel like things have just moved on and you exist together more than you live to love each other together. Well, you know, again, the thing that I love about Plato is that you can take the same lump, it's crazy, I know, some of you are amazed, but like, voila, a snowman, but you know, at the same time too, I can take that same lump and reform it into something else. I can take that same lump of modeling clay and form it into something else. Listen to me, the same lump. And isn't that kind of what God does with us? Isn't that kind of what God does with us? I mean, we even read in Genesis 1:27 that we are created in His image, but when we are born on this earth, we're born into sin. We are born sinners, and that sin is what defines us. And because we sin, We become something far less than what God had initially intended for us to be. However, and look at this with me, through the grace of God and the sacrifice of His Son, Jesus Christ, our hearts and lives can be remolded and made new, just like this Play-Doh. So that when God, our Creator, looks at us, He sees us the way He intended for us to be, because when He sees us, He sees Jesus. When He sees us, He sees perfection. He sees perfection. You know, I know that whether you're here this morning or maybe you're watching via video, there are some people that are ready to call it quits within their marriage. There are some people that are ready to call it quits when it comes to their relationship with their kids, or maybe even their relationship with their parents. They're frustrated. They've tried everything they can do. But here's the thing. That same lump of clay that is your marriage, that is your children, that is your brother, your sister, your whatever, is the same lump of clay that you started with. Think about that for a minute. At one time, and in most of our family relationships in particular, we loved each other, we liked each other, but somehow, and it may be a brother or sister, it may be a wife, it may be a husband, it may be children, whatever it is, those relationships can begin to grow apart. And in our society today, it's when that happens, what do? We burn the bridge. We sever the relationship. And the two that were together become two that are apart. But you know, even in marriage, there's always going to be a connection. There's always going to be a connection within that. That same lump of clay is still there. And you need to realize this. No matter who messed up, no matter how bad the situation might be, no matter how dark it might seem, no matter how bad the miscommunication, no matter how big the wall has gotten, God can take that lump of clay and He can make it and form it back into what it was created to be, what it should be like. Just like He did with you and I when He died on the cross, when He gave His Son Jesus to die on the cross. And for those who believe, we can be made new. We can not be perfect because we're not sinners, but we can stand perfected because of Jesus Christ and His blood. Now, how many of you have heard of the story of Abraham and Sarah? Abraham and Sarah, raise your hand if you know what I'm talking about. Abraham and Sarah. It was Abram and Sarai, I believe, originally as they got started. But Abraham and Sarah, the story is found actually in Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12 is where the story begins, and it goes on for several chapters. And I just want to share with you some small tidbits about that story this morning. First of all, Abraham was the son of Terah, who was the great grandson of Noah, nine times down, okay? So he's related to Noah, okay? So Abraham is the son of Terah, who was in the line of Noah. Abraham married Sarah, who was actually his half-sister, okay? And they didn't live in Kentucky, okay, or West Virginia, or anything like that. It was actually his half-sister. They actually had the same father. Now, I mean, you know, where you have to give them a little bit of grace is you have to understand this is only nine generations after Noah, so the pickings weren't exactly grand at the moment, okay? So he married Sarah, who was you know, actually his half-sister. So at times, you know, if you know the story, Abraham told others that Sarah was his sister, and of course, even though she was actually still his wife, he was telling the truth, but kind of not telling the truth too. Well, God told Abraham to leave his homeland, and He wanted him to go to the land of Canaan. And He said that He would bless him, and He would multiply his children, that they would literally one day outnumber the stars, and that there would be this great nation that would rise up from Abraham's bosom. And see, when I think of Father Abraham, when I think of Abraham, I think of that song. Anybody do that? Father Abraham, you know, and I'm one of the left arm, or well, that's my right arm. But you know, did anybody do that song? How many of you did that song, Father Abraham, you know? But really, he literally is the father of so many generations. But you know, there was a teeny tiny problem in God telling him to go to Canaan, and that he was going to bring up his offspring to be this great nation, and he was going to bless it and everything. You see, Abraham was at that time about 75 years old, okay? So think about that for a moment. He was like 75 years old, and here's another little teeny tiny problem. His wife was barren, okay? And she couldn't have children. So he's 75, she's not far behind, and they have no children, and he says, hey, I want you to go over here, and first of all, you got to travel this long distance, and I'm going to raise up this incredible nation from your children. And Abraham says, okay, well, let's get to it, and we'll see how that works out. However, all the while, God reassured Abraham. He made a promise to him that this was going to happen. And so Abraham did trust that. Let's look at just a little bit of that in Genesis 15, chapters 1 through verses 1 through 6, if you want to look with me. It says this. It says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram. And again, at that time, he was still Abram. In a vision, fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. Not Eleazar, he's one of our elders, but this is Eliezer, okay, of Damascus. And Abram said, behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir, your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and number the stars. If you are able to number them, then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. So, here we got Abraham, and he's moved on to Canaan, and it's been about 10 years. He's been living there about 10 years, and guess what? They still don't have a child. So Abraham and Sarah, now he's like 85, she's not far behind, they're not getting any younger, and so she started saying, look, this isn't going to happen, there's no way this is going to happen, I'm just not going to get pregnant, so here's what you need to do. I want you to sleep with my maidservant and, you know, have a child with her. This has got to be how this is going to work, because it's obviously not working with me. And so Abraham slept with Sarah's maidservant, Hagar. And guess what? Yep, she got pregnant. She got pregnant. And not only that, she began to look down on Sarah. She began to look down on her. You know why? Because she said, you know what? I got pregnant and you can't. So I must be better than you are. So she began to look down on her, and there became this big rift between the two of them. Plus, truth be told, Hagar thought that Abraham was pretty hot for a guy that was 90. I mean, you know, you might have too if you were in that same situation. But she got pregnant, and she eventually had this child. But here's the thing I want you to understand here. Abraham and Sarah, they had grown impatient with God. You know, like, where's this child? You promised this, but it's not happening. And you know, we can kind of do that sometimes in our lives too, you know. Even though we read of God's promises and God's word, and we know what he says is true, that he answers our prayers, that he hears us, all those things, there's some of those times where we go, man, you know, okay, this is not happening. I got to do something here. And usually those are the times when we get ourselves in trouble, and it's exactly what Abraham and Sarah did. And so they made this choice, and here, Hagar had a baby. And it wasn't the chosen child that God was talking about. In fact, this child's name was Ishmael. Ishmael. And really, he was born out of Sarah and Abraham's impatience. He was born out of their struggle. And instead of trusting God, they took things into their own hands, like I said, which is what a lot of us do. And a nation did rise up from Ishmael. A nation did rise up out of this poor choice, this mistake, this disobedience to God. And that nation is very well alive today. It's actually the fastest growing religion in our country, and it's called the Nation of Islam. Well, praise be to God that he still had mercy and grace on Abraham and Sarah. And when Abraham was 100 years of age, God gave Abraham and Sarah a son. And his name was Isaac. God had honored his promise, and of course it wasn't in the timing that they had hoped it would be, but God had honored his promise. And we now know, looking on this side of things, that a great nation did rise up from Isaac. A great nation that brought about people like King David, Solomon, Ruth, and Joseph, the earthly father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, in spite of their disobedience and in spite of that mistake, God still had a plan for Abraham and Sarah. He still had a plan to redeem his people. And even though they messed up, they got off track, they made a terrible mistake, God still honored his promise. He didn't say, you know what? Forget you guys. You know, I'm not messing with that mold of clay anymore. He didn't do that. What he did was he said, you know what? You made a mistake, and you didn't obey me like I had hoped you would, but he took them and he molded them back into what he had intended for them to be. And that's grace, and that's forgiveness, and that's love. And it's what's modeled for us through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And they had that child who became the generation that would bring about generations and generations in a line that would eventually bring about Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Now, were there consequences for their mistake? Oh, yeah. There were huge consequences for their mistake. Huge, lasting consequences for their mistake. And listen, let me tell you this, because this is something that's really hard for a lot of us to swallow. Consequences are a part of life. Consequences are a part of life. You know, I can remember at times when I was a kid, or even a youth, or even times when I've been an adult, and there's those times where, man, you something happens, and it's because maybe you did something wrong, or maybe it's because something didn't go the way you hoped it would, and you say, oh man, you know, do I have to deal with the consequences? Do I, you know, it's like the kid that says, do I have to be grounded for a whole week? I mean, I've got this thing on Friday. What about just 4 days or whatever else so that I can still go to this thing? But the reality is, there's still consequences for those actions, and those consequences can be lasting. Those consequences can be lifelong. And just as though, even though Abraham and Sarah were able to experience the grace and mercy of God by allowing them to have the son that he had promised them, the consequences of their mistake in going ahead of him are lasting and eternal. And now are a religion that doesn't proclaim Jesus Christ as the only way to get to God, that is running rampant in this nation and nations all over the world, growing faster than Christianity. That's consequences. But here's the thing. You might not be able to do anything about the consequences of your past, but what you can do is learn from them. Learn from them. Grow from them. You know, when you do something wrong, learn from it and go on. So many people live in the midst of their consequences. They see their life as a result of this. I did this, so here I am. This is what I am. Our marriage went through this, or maybe somebody stepped out on the marriage, or maybe a child made this kind of decision, or maybe you didn't raise your children the way that you believed you should, or maybe you struggled with certain things while your children were young, or whatever else, and they say, this is who I am. No, that's not who you are. Who you are is a wonderful creation of God. Who you are is someone that has all the potential to have all the same grace and forgiveness and love and mercy that comes from our God. Who you are is someone who has the potential to be forgiven of their sins through the grace and mercy and love of Jesus Christ. Who you are, through God's eyes, is one of his wonderful children that he loves. And maybe that person in your family that you're having a struggle with, that there's a wedge between you and them, maybe you see them as an enemy. But let me just say this to you, whether it's a child or a parent or a partner in marriage, they too are a wonderful creation of God. They're loved. God sees them in the light of His love. He sees them as in all of their potential. If He sees them, if they are a Christian, He sees Jesus when He looks at them. If they're not a Christian, He sees the potential for them to come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. But so often we see with our earthly eyes when we look at people, and we become blinded, and those walls go up, and we build our house on anything less than God, anything less than His Word, anything less than how He sees us. We need to look at each other through the eyes of love, through the eyes of Christ. And you know, it's a choice. It really is. So much in life is a choice. I know, and it's hard. It is a choice. And whether or not your marriage or home life or your family life begins to change is really up to you. You hear me? It's up to you. You know, I know situations, and listen, there's times when Kelly and I know this is going to shock you, don't get along. And I know there's those times where, man, you're frustrated at your partner, and they've done something to tick you off, and the last thing you want to do is love them. Last thing you want to do. Because, you know, they've said something that hurt you or whatever else, and what you want to do is hurt them back. Praise God that God didn't do that to us, because I know that my life and things I've done in my life have hurt God, but He looked back with me in eyes of love and said, you know what? I am still going to offer you my grace and my mercy and my love because you are my child. You know, if you are married today, God has entrusted that person in your marriage to you to love. If you are here today and you have a child, if your child has done drugs, your child's made mistakes, you know, whatever the case might be, and it may cause you to be frustrated, angry, or whatever else, God has given you that child to love them, to give them the grace and mercy that He has given you. And listen, your ministry before anything else in this world is to that individual. That's where your ministry begins, in the home. The reason our country, the reason the United States, the reason we live in a city demographic where the majority of people don't go to church anymore is because the reality is we've stopped. We've stopped caring enough, loving enough about one another to instill the things in one another that matter. To love one another with a kind of love that can only come and flow out of a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's who we need to be. That's who we're called to be. And listen, I know whenever there's a sermon like this, there's people that are pointing fingers. They're saying, well, you know, this is for him today. This is for her today. This is, I'm glad my mom's here today because you know what? Yeah, let me tell you, the way she acts towards me, she doesn't love me, I can tell you. Or, I'm glad my kids are here today, because man, they need this. No. No finger pointing today. Because the bottom line is, no matter what type of situation you're facing right now, you have a responsibility to love, no matter what. And sometimes what breaks down the walls, what breaks the cycle, is that person. Maybe you are the one that's been wounded. Maybe that's a reality. But you know what? That person that's been wounded, that person that's been hurt, you know what? If you love, you've all seen the Grinch, right? You've seen that cartoon. His heart melted, shrunk down. It's a cartoon, but the same thing can happen in our lives. When we love, in spite of maybe even our circumstances, in spite of how we feel, in spite of the relationship, Psalms 127 says this. I want you to listen to this, really think about this. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Listen to me. Some of you are wondering why things are going so awry in your life. I'm not kidding this morning. I want you to listen to me. Here's the key. You are not building your house the way God has called you to build it. You're not loving your kids the way God's called you to love them. You're not loving your spouse the way God has called you to love them. And it says very clearly, unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. Listen to this. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for he grants sleep to those he loves. Don't miss that verse. There are so many people that are tired, they're depressed, they're frustrated, they're going through all these difficult situations, and they're working their tails off to try to make everybody happy in their house. But the bottom line is, when we make it a point to put God first in our relationships, we make it a point to make God the cornerstone of our house. Things come together in a way that they only can when he is our foundation. There are so many people I know that, you know, they come to church and, you know, good morning, good to see you this morning, boy, I love you, brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so or whatever else. And they get in the car and they're like, you know, man, I tell you what, man, I got to go to beep, 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 you know, and they're wondering why, you know, well, Johnny, I saw on Facebook that you said so-and-so was a beep. Where did you get that from? Well, come on. They're learning from us. You know, or when it comes to our relationship again with our spouse or whatever else. I'm going to tell you, after a while, if you live with somebody that's angry and irritable, you're going to become angry and irritable too. Either that or you're going to go into a shell and things are just going to seize up. It's no way to live. It's no way to live. We're going to be talking about this more over the next few weeks. I encourage you to be here as we do. So in other words, unless or until your marriage and or your family are built, are led God's way, you will labor in vain. Oh, let me read the second part here. I almost missed it. It says, children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. I know some of you are going, no, you don't know my children. Yeah. Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is a man whose quiver, and I was like, what is a quiver? I got to look that up. Actually, a quiver is the thingy that holds the arrows, okay? So just in case you're wondering, because I thought it maybe was like related to a liver, but it's not, okay? Or I thought it was when you're really cold, but that's shiver, all right? But blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court. Listen, you know, I was thinking about that warrior, and I was thinking about those arrows. You know, arrows can be used for good, or they can be used for bad, can't they? You know, you can have a warrior with arrows, man, that's coming against you and get you in the wrong way. Or you can have a quiver full of arrows that are doing the right thing. But the key is the first part of that passage, the first part of Psalms 127. Man, if the Lord's building the house, and if he is the head of the warrior, and he is your focus of what you're doing, those children are going to be raised up in such a way that they are going to be mighty and strong, that they are going to not put you to shame. Parents, some of us need to spend more time with our kids. Some of you need to be home more. Some of you need to do with less so that your kids can have more. Maybe we don't need cable and all 800 channels. Maybe we don't need some of the bells and whistles that we think we do so that mom and dad can be there and make a difference in the home. Maybe there needs to be some serious conversations about how things are going on and some readjustments that are made. Some of you are sitting here this morning and say, well, what do I do? I'm in this hole, man. My marriage, my family, my relationships, they're suffering. They're already messed up. My kids are already grown. Because I know some of you are thinking that today. You're thinking, my kids are already grown. My family relationships, man, I'm already been out of the house. Because some of you have relationship issues with people that don't live with you anymore. Well, here's what you do. You decide today. You make the choice, listen to me, the choice today that you are going to change your family tree. That you are going to change your family tree. And just like Abraham and Sarah, you know, they had to deal with consequences of past mistakes. There were still consequences that were there. But just like them, God can take your marriage. God can take your kids, and no matter how old they are, your family relationships, and he can mold them into everything he intended for them to be. Did it happen when Abraham and Sarah wanted it to happen? No. And what happened? Man, they got so frustrated and irritated, they said, well, I got to do something. You know, time's running out. They didn't trust God. They became impatient. They decided to do things their way. One of the hardest things for us to do, Christians, is to stay on track with God's will and God's plans for our lives. It's one of the hardest things for us to do. Because we still, in our finite minds, think that at times we can do things better. That we can make things happen quicker, that maybe God needs our help because maybe he's not really hearing my prayer. Maybe the line's got some static or it's been disconnected. No, it's not that at all. Maybe sometimes God is wanting to shape you and mold you, even through the difficulty, even through the pain, into a little bit more of what he would have for you to be. Maybe it's for you. Maybe it's for somebody else that you're going to help down the road. Or maybe it's for something that you're not even sure of right now. You've got to trust him. You've got to trust that if you follow him and he is the Lord of all creation, he's the one who created it all, he's the one who sustains it all, he's the one who can do it all, that he will take you through it all. You've got to trust him. God is faithful. His compassion and his mercies are new every morning. In Lamentations 3:22 through 23 from the NIV, it says, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." Every morning. No matter where you're at this morning. No matter what the past has been, his mercies and his compassions are new today. They're new today. Today was all about evaluation and teardown. And I hope what you've done is you've thought a little bit about your family life. Your kids, your marriage. You know, over the next few weeks, we're going to get specific on some of these things. When we talk about marriage, when we talk about the kids, when we talk about coming together as a family, we're going to spend more time on that. So there's a lot of things I didn't cover today that we'll be covering in future weeks. Today was to make you think, what about my life needs remolded? What about my life? Do I need to say, Lord, here's what I have. Here's the lump of my marriage. Here's the lump of my kids and my family. Lord, make them into what you would have them to be. Lord, make them into what you intended for them to be. I want you to ask you a few questions as we close. What about your home, your family life? Your family needs a do-over. What walls do you need to tear down so your marriage, your family can be rebuilt? Sometimes there's those walls, man, that are just separating us. Bitterness, frustration, past experiences. You are not your circumstances. You're not your consequences. Yes, they do affect our lives, but you are much more than your situation. You are wonderfully and fearfully made, according to the Psalms. You are a child of the King, created in his image, Genesis 1:27. What do you need to get honest about with your spouse? Honest with your kids about? You know, sometimes, let me just say this, parents. You know, I'm one of these parents. I love my kids, and I hate punishing them. Because you know what? And you know this, if you're a parent, it hurts my heart. It really does. It hurts my heart sometimes. Because I want them to do fun things too. I want them to have fun. But you know what? You know what's going to hurt their heart a lot worse? Is if you don't take the responsibility to love them with hard love. You have to love them with hard love, and you have to bring them up in the ways of the Lord, because they're the best ways. Are you willing to lay aside your pride this morning, maybe even your hurt, so that the demolition and reconstruction can begin? Some of you need to lay aside that. Maybe the person that you have issues with this morning isn't even here. But what needs to be torn down is in you. What do you need to lay aside this morning? And let me just ask you this. And I want you to be honest here. Parents, spouses, dads, mom. And listen, you might be here this morning and you're single and you know, you're not married, but you're going to be married someday. But all of us are a part of a family in some way. All of these things can apply to our lives, whether we help somebody else or whether they literally apply right now or whether they apply down the road. But the question is this: is God the head, the builder of your family? Is He the head of your house? Do you live? Do you build your house? Do you build your family according to His design? Because anything else, you'll build in vain. You'll work, you'll toil, but you'll be restless. Because unless the house is built on the rock of our Lord and Savior, it's built in vain.